Hello, and thank you for joining us for our weekly business roundup. My name is Viola Kusasira, and we are glad to have you. We are joined by Paul Busharizi, and that's our analyst for this week. He works with the New Vision as a business journalist. Thank you, Paul, for joining us. We appreciate your time. Let's start off with the increase in investment in the oil and gas sector, and that's about 5.5 trillion shillings since the signing of the final investment decision last year in February. What are some of the activities that have spurred this growth, and what more can we expect from the sector?
Yeah, of course, all the preparation work leading up to first oil in 2025 is where all this money is coming. A lot of it is just laying down the infrastructure, setting up the central processing unit, I think they call it, which all the oil fields would feed into and process it into raw stuff, into crude oil, which will go into the pipeline. Of course, there's investment in the pipeline, which is also ongoing, and several other things. So that's basically what's happening. We're getting ready for first oil, which is expected in 2025.
And how best can Ugandans benefit from this large sector that we see is growing before our eyes, rather than just sit and wait for what happens? How best can we get to be a part of it?
The preparation for this has been going on for ages. I think since we find commercial levels of oil in 2006, and I saw the other day somebody went to the oil fields and found a lot of Ugandans working there, not only as manual workers, but also as experts in the field of oil, oil and processing. So the action was, it's a bit too late to be prepared for oil now if you're Ugandan. The people who are benefiting from it are already in the field.
All right, Paul, so the Economic Policy Research Center has called upon government to be more transparent with the date, the national date. And I would believe that's in terms of payment, of acquisition, of spending. How best can we, as a country, make sure that the date is transparent, especially for new lenders that are coming in, like China and several other countries?
I think we have a problem with how we handle our debt, and as you said, in the acquisition and the utilization and the payment of it. I think, first of all, I think we're not, it has been shown, it's been reported, that our rate of absorption is very poor with debt. What that means is that we have access to the money, but we don't fulfill certain criteria and therefore we can't use it, which is a really big worry. And it's costing us. So I think there's quite a bit of debt that we actually don't use, but we're paying for it, which is really, really sad. And then, of course, the contracting of debt. We seem to be a bit opportunistic instead of strategic. You know, somebody flashes some money in front of us and we take it up and stuff like that. But I think those days are numbered because our debt levels have reached to a point where sustainability is really becoming a problem. So I think those days are numbered.
And finally, Paul, government has said that prioritizing agriculture would see the country grow faster than we are at the moment. Do you think this is something that is doable? And really, if it is, we've always known agriculture to be that space where we can have growth. So how come government is only realizing this?
Well, I think anybody who knows Uganda, it's a no-brainer that agriculture has to be the thing we invest in, if only because 7 in every 10 Ugandans derive a livelihood from agriculture. So it just makes sense that we need to focus on that. I mean, I don't even think that should be a topic in the 21st century. So now with debt, the question then becomes, how do you invest in agriculture? You can't just throw money at it. But research has shown that the key drivers of agriculture in a country like ours would be, one, extension services, where you have people going out and teaching people better agricultural practices. And, they would be the conduit through you, which you pass technology like improved seeds, improved fertilizer, or the growing of new crops, or that kind of thing. Secondly, be irrigation. That's where government can invest in, because we're blessed in Uganda. We have two rain seasons. We have two rain seasons, so we can actually have two crop seasons in this country. But with irrigation, who knows? We can probably even have three. So we are batting way below our potential. And those are the two investments. Even talk about debt, it would be very good to invest in extension services and irrigation. No, it makes sense to invest in the human resource, and there you're talking about in education and in health, because an educated population is a more productive one. A healthy one, of course, similarly, is a more productive one. So that's where they should be investing. But in the PDM, it's I think the biggest pillar is really about data collection, and of course agriculture, helping people improve the agricultural thing. That's what PDM does a lot of. Of course, there's a bit of financial inclusion. They make money accessible to the rural areas through the PDM, and those should also be winners.
All right, thank you so much, Paul. That's what we had time for today. Until next time, we are glad that you came through. And thank you very much, DFVO, for always making time. This is what we had time for this week, but make sure to catch the Business Roundup every Friday on the news at 9 p.m. I am Vailak Sasia. Good night.